Before I turn this over to Rick Telberg, a brief word about our speaker today. Rick is the president and CEO of Bay Street Group, LLC. Rick is the longtime publisher of CPA Trendlines, a leading source of real research into what's happening in the accounting industry and with public accountants. Rick is consistently recognized as one of the top 100 most influential people in accounting. And Accounting Today said, and I can't say it any better, that Mr. Telberg may well be the accounting profession's most widely known commentator and researcher. So without further ado, I'd like to go ahead and turn this over to Rick Telberg.
Diz, thank you very much. I appreciate that introduction. That was most kind, and I appreciate the opportunity to present some of our findings from CPA Trendlines today to the Accountants World audience. Welcome, everybody, and thank you to Accountants World. Just a quick sound check. Let me know if there's any problem with the sound. And we will get started. If anybody has any questions for me now or later, email them. We can use the chat box on our screens. We can use the question box on our screens. I encourage everybody to get involved in real time as things come up. We have a lot of ground to cover today. We have almost 200 pages of material when you put it all together between the PowerPoint and PDF. We're not going to cover all of that. We're going to cover what I think are some of the most important issues and the most important trends. Let's take a look. We're gonna take a look at the outlook. We're gonna analyze it. We're gonna posit a forecast. We're gonna go over some tips, tactics, and strategies to make this hopefully the best busy season ever. And it might not be easy based on what we're faced with. I mean, let's just take a look at the headlines, what we're dealing with. We're dealing with tax reform. Big question, big, huge question. I'm not even paying much attention to the news at this point because I haven't seen anything in writing. We're dealing with all sorts of things that can affect the business. Healthcare, they tried three times to reform or repeal. Who knows what could happen in the next few months? And one of the things that worries me, and I know worries a lot of tax professionals in both cases here, what happens at the end of the year or at the beginning of next year that could possibly really derail 2018? Disaster relief. Texas, Florida, Puerto Rico, major markets are disrupted. Major industries are disrupted. Clients across the country are affected by this stuff. At the same time, we're dealing with questions about that infrastructure initiative. Still waiting to see that. How's that going to affect things? And top it all off, do we really have to talk about nuclear war? It is just awesome the kinds of things that we're dealing with. So these are just some of the questions we're going into 2018 with. Now, in your material, you'll find three or four different parts. What we're going to focus on today are compiling some of the reporting and analysis that we've done throughout 2017 and see what that might mean for 2018. Also in the materials that you download, you'll find a slew of data points, so we'll go over some of them today, ranging from IRS filing statistics and pricing surveys to emerging markets and tightening talent pools. And then you'll also find a collection of articles containing some of the really smart, practice-proven advice from one of our leading authors, Ed Mendelowitz. He's the author of How to Review Tax Return and a Tax Season Opportunity Guide and How to Build a Stronger Tax Practice, and that's available from the store at cpatrendlines.com. Really essential reading if you want to tune up your practice. And then also in your materials, I think it's time for this business to start thinking beyond the traditional tax practice business model. beyond the beyond busy season. It's clear the tax business is changing and tax professionals need to change with it. And in the PDF you download, you'll find some pointers about ideas for a four season year round business model that should smooth things out and go a long way to transitioning us beyond the 1040 business model. So, are you ready? Div, I think we're ready for our first poll question.
Okay, sounds great. So I'll go ahead and open up the first poll here. And folks, you should be seeing the poll question in front of you right now. The question is, how concerned are you about politics affecting your busy season 2018? There are four options there. Select the one that best applies to you. And don't forget to click the submit button to make sure that your vote is counted. Just a reminder, the voting in all three of the poll questions is required in order to earn CP today. All right, so looks like we've got about 90% of people having voted at this point, so we'll take a couple of more minutes here for people to, or a couple of more seconds here for people to get their votes in. Let's give about 10 more seconds.
And Div, can everybody see the poll progress results?
I don't think they can yet, so I think they'll have to wait until I close out the poll. So, folks, we've got less than 5 seconds here. Going once.
No spoilers alert. Right.
All right. So, Rick, what we see is just under half of people say somewhat concerned. I need to keep an eye on things. A little under a third said moderately concerned, and then the rest split between not at all or freaking out.
Dave, hold that on the screen for a few minutes, if you would. And sure. If people have additional comments and you want to use the question box or the chat box, please feel free to do so. Well, it's nice to know only 4% of the people are actually freaking out. That's the good news. But 48 and 31% have some degree of concern. I think that we're going to compare those numbers, where we are today, with where we were about a year ago at this time. All in all, 2017 was one of the best tax seasons ever. Spoiler alert, that's what our data shows. And it might be one of the last of the best ones, because the way 2018 is shaping up, there is plenty of room for lots of trouble. We're looking at 2017 was one of the best in producing the fewest headaches, problems. We only had routine problems and late paperwork and tardy clients. There were problems in staffing and production and technology and even IRS response times, but those were down from the year before. Next year could be real trouble, and it's one of my big concerns. They talk about perfect storms. We're looking at possible chaos and delay. We've got the new administration talking about a massive overhaul of the tax code. That's not going to be clean. It's going to be messy. It's probably not going to be on time. It's probably going to cause big hassles with the IRS and getting forms out on time. It's really going to compress busy season even further. And then we've got a lot of regulatory changes that are piling up. And then, of course, there's the uncertainties about healthcare. So that alone means that there's going to be a whole lot of effort devoted at the last minute to understand the changes, to grasp it, a lot of last minute CPE, a lot of last minute changes to software that leads to delays and problems and glitches and bugs. I mean, if we get a tax code overhaul as big as they say It could be as big as 1986 and the Reagan deal. And if you remember the Tax Reform Act of 1986, it was one of the biggest and most controversial of its time. People were in an uproar for 2 years. That thing went on for 2 years before it went into law. It nearly died several times. And eventually, when it passed, it produced a simpler code, and there were fewer tax breaks and significantly lower rates. Of course, there were a lot of amendments after that, a lot of tax rate increases after that, which we tend to forget, and that added to the complexity. But the changes affected every family and business in the nation. I mean, they were so broad, so sweeping, that it's now considered, I think, one of the reasons that we had a massive number of retirements in this business and a surge in mergers and acquisitions after 1986. And it lasted for about a decade through 1996. So if we get something as big as that this year or even next year, added to all the other changes that are going on in the business, I mean, the picture of the tax business going forward is hard to picture. And then added the 2012 style government shutdown. When a Congress hits gridlock in December and nothing happens, and tax season 2018 could be stopped before it even starts. And then the third thing is even more ominous. As we looked at the data from last year, e-filings by tax professionals were down about 4 or 5% from the same time the previous year. Now, if that continues, it will have marked the first time in the modern era when tax professionals gave up market share to do-it-yourselfers. That is a turning point. That means something if you're in just the 1040 business. That means that the 1040 business will be officially on the decline irretrievably, and we have to start thinking about what we do without 1040s. So, I mean, let's get it straight. Lots of people are still making a good living doing taxes. And lots of people are going to continue to make a really good living doing taxes. But it's not going to be quite the same as it used to be. It's 2018, if you haven't already, will be a year when you're thinking about reinventing yourself, reinventing your practice, reinventing your client base, reinventing your technology, or moving on. And I think it's quite possible that we'll see a shakeout, either going into 2018 or coming out of 2018. It is a serious concern of mine. So let me take a closer look at what 2017 looked like. And it wasn't bad at all. The CPA Trendline's busy season barometer for 2017, by the end of the year, only 8% of the people had a much worse year. 21% had a somewhat worse year. 23% had the same year, which is pretty good considering the year before was pretty good too. And about 48% had an even better year. And we measure that by a number of benchmarks, which we're going to get into. And I'm interested to see how that is going to reflect on 2018. And we're going to take a look at some of the trends and how that changes throughout the season. Right here. So if you take a look at the lower left-hand corner, the data we received in December versus the data at the end of April, and you take a look at the blue and the green lines, which are the positive outcomes. The blue line went down from the beginning of the year, and the green line went down from the beginning of the year. So the people who thought they were going to have a better year diminished. The number of people who thought they were going to have a worse year, on the other hand, increased. What does that tell you? It tells you that it won't be as good as you think, but don't worry, it won't be as bad as you think. It's interesting how that works out that way. And it does change. It is that unpredictable. Now, when we go look at it from a long-term point of view, 2017, the green is 17% much better, 30% somewhat, 23 same, 21 somewhat worse, and 7.6 much worse. But still in the rest of the years there. So, let's go. Right there. So 2016 was a terrific year, 23%, much better. 2015 is actually a pretty typical year. But 2013, remember that 2012 government shutdown? That was a real killer. That was a tax season from hell. Just like the 1988, I think it was the 1987 or the 88 season was also called the tax season. So over the long term, these are some of the trends that we follow at CPA Trendlines. Let's go over some of the troubles and triumphs. These are the kinds of issues that crop up from time to time. Year in and year out, these are the trouble spots. If you have any to add, let me know in the chat box. Clients late or unprepared, always a big deal. Late or erroneous K-1s, 1099, staffing issues, IRS operations, tax code and reg changes, competition from others, general economic situation, personal family issues, those are true, whether you like it or you can't plan for that. Pricing and fee pressures and setting enough time to plan is always an issue, interestingly enough. I think everybody on the call today, everybody watching this webinar today, is already ahead of the game in terms of planning ahead. So congratulate yourselves for that. And office workflow processes. That's a big one. So, Dev, I think we're ready for the next poll.
Okay, great.
Question is,
let me go ahead and launch that.
Okay. Which of these issues?
Yep, go ahead.
Nope. I'm just going to say that the question is, which of these issues are you most concerned about this year? Late or erroneous K-1s, 1099s, et cetera, or clients being late or unprepared, or technology and software problems, or security, privacy, and identity theft issues, or tax code and reg changes in IRS operations. Let's get an idea of what we should be looking out for this year.
All right, it looks like we've had about 5 seconds to get the vote. So we'll give about 10 more seconds for people to go ahead and select their option.
And then remember to click the submit button to make sure that your vote is counted.
Okay. 3, 2, 1, and we're closed. So, Rick, the most concerning one to people was tax code and regulatory changes slash IRS operations, followed pretty closely by later unprepared clients and security, privacy, and identity theft issues.
Thank you. Just keep that up a little while. Let's take a closer look at that. Let's see if anybody has any questions or comments to add to that. Tax code and reg changes. All right. A lot of people agree with me. I'm concerned about that. And that leads, of course, to clients being late and unprepared. But you know, the good news here is technology and software problems. Very, very interesting. I think we're at a place where people have their tech stack set up the way they want it. I think there's going to be, if they haven't already, they have it now. They have the technology that they're going to go into the game with. It worked last year. It should work this year. All they need to do is update it. And I think that is a very encouraging sign. Very encouraging. Now, thank you, Dick. What else should we remember? Let's take a look at the difference between 2017 and 2016 in those exact areas. Later erroneous K-1s, 1099s, and et cetera were the big new problem. They surged in terms of issues. Up 31% of people reporting problems in later erroneous K-1s, up from 22% the year before, followed by 49% of people reporting problems with clients being late or unprepared, up 28%. That was a percent change, not points. And the rounding for the decimals. Personal and family issues, 12%. I mean, you can be pretty sure that some personal or family issues are going to affect 16 to 18% of practices in any given year. And that is an interesting issue. That is a very interesting issue that goes to the way we do business, the way we distribute work, right? Our work processes. And it throws a monkey wrench and a wild card into how we operate as business people. I mean, would we recommend any of our clients sustain that kind of uncertainty over time? Are we staffed for it? Are we geared for it? Do we have the backup we need? I think that is a manageable problem. Just as I think the clients being late or unprepared is a manageable problem. There's still time to get ahead of the curve with clients being late or unprepared. There's still time to schedule those end of the year tax planning meetings. And heck, why can't we bill extra for it? Build it into the annual bill. Make it part of the tax return. This is what they get for coming to you. And I think it's a great way to add margin to the business. New counting and auditing issues, changed decimal point. And the things that actually improved, there was less concerns about competition from others. Security, privacy, and identity theft were a big issue at about a third of practitioners. On today's call, it was a significant issue as well. Tax code and reg changes. We had a nice smooth year. People get that this year? Apparently not. 32% of people on this call say we're going to get slammed with tax code and reg changes. And IRS operations went better than the year before. I don't know if we can say that about this year. Staffing issue last year went better than the year before. There's still a chance. There's still an opportunity. It's only October to get the staffing issues out of the way now. Get the training issues out of the way now. If staffed up, it is not too late. This is a major manageable opportunity. So let's take a look at manageable opportunities here. Dealing with clients, dealing with staffing issues, dealing with security, technology should not be a problem. people seem to be on top of it. No, nothing wrong in double checking that. Office workflows and processes. It was an improvement last year. There should be an improvement this year. I think, you know, one of the reasons that people are on this call, and one of the things you can take away from this webinar today, is what can you do differently this year from last year? You still have about 3 months, maybe more, to get that done. And think about how it might affect all of these other issues. Get those processes in place. Pushing out tax returns is very much an industrial system. We approach it like a professional service, but think about our manufacturing clients. It is an assembly line system, and there are ways to make it work better. Last year, pricing and fee pressures weren't as bad as the year before. That's interesting. Now, I'm not quite sure it's because everybody raised fees together or everybody's making enough money so they didn't have to raise fees. But it also tells me that there is room there for people to raise. If you haven't raised fees yet, this is a good time to do it. Offer that pre-planning session. Make it a bundled arrangement. Throw in the tax planning and the tax return and the tax extension. Charge a little more, get a little more. This is a great time to lock in people for next year. And setting aside enough time to plan. That was less of a problem last year than the year before. I hope it's less of a problem this year than it was last year as well. And the general economic situation was generally better last year. I'm not sure what we can say about that this year. The stock market looks good, although hiring among small business, where most of our clients are, has been flat for a long time. So it's a mixed bag. It depends a lot on one-time factors. I mean, we're talking about hurricanes and disasters. We're talking about regional disparities. We're talking about rural versus urban. We're talking industry by industry. But generally, the economy is moving steadily forward. Not robust, but steady. But it's wrong to generalize because we know, just as all politics is local, all tax prep is local. So we're going to see how that shakes out this year. So let's recap. Late or erroneous K-1s were surged as a problem by 42%. Clients being late and unprepared, and personal and family issues. Later erroneous K-1s were at the mercy of other accountants and financial institutions. But we can deal with clients being late or unprepared. We can't deal necessarily with personal family issues, but we can deal with who's going to step in for us or our key people if something happens. And then the triumphs. We can't do much about the general economic situation, which was a real triumph for this year, but we can learn that setting aside enough time to plan, that smart pricing, that smart planning and office workflows can really make a difference. So these are places where we made real gains last year. And I think these are gains where we can make that we can make this year as well. So when we're planning for triumphs, what do we do about the general economic situation? You know your community, you know your industry, you know your locality, you know your clients better than anyone else. What can you be doing now to help them through whatever's going on in their economic lives? What can you be doing now to prepare them for the best and to prepare them for the worst And don't you think they're going to thank you for the time you take now to do that? And we always say tax season doesn't start until sometime in January or February. No, tax season starts today. This is the beginning of tax season. For everybody here today, this is the first day of tax season. Extension season is over. This is the first day of tax season 2018. Let's get rolling. We've got some flexibility in pricing and fee pressures. There's some data in your handouts that shows you what the average prices are across the country for certain products and services. Of course, those are only generalizations, but yeah, I mean, you know how that works. Suppose you raise your prices across the board by 5% and you lost 5% of your clients. Do the math. Which 5% of your clients would you lose? And office workflow processes. This is a chance to install something. This is the chance to do something better. Staffing issues. You got to lock down the clients and you got to lock down the staff. So when we look at the, when we drill down into the numbers and we look at the change of number of clients from prior year, what we're seeing is that, you know, a seemingly robust 59% of practitioners were reporting an increase in number of clients this year over the year before, including 19% calling there's a significant increase, usually, I mean, 10% or more. But last year, the year before, 63% reported increases in client traffic. That's well within the margin of error, but it stands as a warning signal, a signal that it might be getting tougher to get the same number of clients. So instead of thinking about numbers of clients, let's start thinking about the quality of clients. Let's start thinking about the lifetime value of a client. And so let's start thinking about what a client is worth. And then when we start thinking about what a client is worth, what's it worth to obtain that client in terms of the billable time that we spend unbillable finding them, or the money we spend investing in marketing or sales. And when we think in terms of lifetime value of a client, then we start to think in terms as well of those add-on sales, which are really, really valuable and high margins. Change in total revenue from prior year. The good news is, even as client traffic may have fallen off last year, total billings advanced. So we're learning something here. More than 70% of professionals reported year-over-year gains in top-line income. And that keeps pace with the rate reported the year before. That's terrific. That means the industry is learning, is mastering how to maintain top line income, even in the face of increasing difficulty in expanding number of clients. And the numbers reporting declines in billings also declined. So we're on the right track. Change in net profit from prior year. The bottom line is the bottom line. And there's good news here too. Two-thirds of professionals are reporting year-over-year gains in net profits, up a little bit from 2016. In addition, the 2017 number represents decreases in profit from 2006, decreases in the decrease. So we're looking at a business that's healthy and getting healthier through 2017. And I think that is going to be a challenge to match that in 2018. Can we get the same advances and gains in 2018 that we got in 2017? Have we banked the profits from last year? Are we setting them aside and buying a lake house with them, or are we putting them back into the business? And I think 2018 is a decision year for that. We're going to find out what the profession looks like after 2018. And then we can plan for triumphs in terms of revenue per client from prior year. About 60% tax practitioners report advances in billings per client. So it's doable. 60% are increasing billings per client. That's about the same as the year before. And it's a sign of some healthy maneuvering room in pricing and fees. So clients will understand that the world got complicated this year. If their economic situation, if their personal economic situation hasn't deteriorated or has gotten better, I think there's plenty of room for price increases. Change in profit per client. The trends in profitability per client are stable and strong. In fact, you can see some ticks to the upside. Maybe the investments that the business made in prior years in technology are finally producing the smooth operational workflows that maximize margins. And I think that the investments that the industry is making in technology are helping workflows, and they're reducing staffing pressures as well. This really interesting new data about the supply and demand of CPA talent on the market, and the fact that most CPA firms are not planning to increase headcount this year. They may be increasing payroll budgets, but they're not necessarily increasing headcounts. So technology is doing more. People are getting paid better. Partner and owner income is surging. It's incredible because we've got a lot of partners and owners retiring and not being replaced. And with fewer partners and owners per staff, where you do the math, partner and owner incomes are surging. So this is a really good business to make a really good living if you do it right. The change in number on extension from prior year. I'm never sure whether this is a good news or bad news, actually. The smoother workflows are trending toward fewer extensions. I think that's an indication that the compression overload of tax season eased up a little bit. More practitioners in 2007 could end their tax season on tax day than they could tax day the year before. And maybe that's happy news for many. And maybe that's an opportunity for many more to get a jump on the changes sure to come going forward. I'll be real interested to see about tax extensions. And one thing I've been hearing all year is finding ways to charge extra for people who go on extension because of their dereliction of duty. Not because you got overwhelmed, but because they brought in a shoebox on April 13th. And I think there's really some interesting pricing schemes that I've heard about this year, where if you bring in your stuff early, you get one price. You bring in your stuff late, you get a different kind of price. And I think that's only fair. And I think clients really do understand that unless they've got some kind of extenuating circumstances. So let's take a look at how these troubles and triumphs translate into what I would call winners and losers. And Div or Sharon, I think we're ready for poll number 3. What will you be doing differently this year?
All right, so I think it's been launched now. So folks, you should see the third poll question in front of you. Please go ahead and answer that and remember to click submit there. Ha ha.
right, most people have voted at this point. We'll give about 10 more seconds for people to get their votes in. Okay, so last call here. Please select one and click submit if you haven't already done so. Going once, going twice. Okay. So Rick, we see a pretty even split between I will start planning earlier and I will reach out to clients proactively, and then about half as many for invest in new software, tech, or get more clients.
That's terrific. I mean, it's absolutely terrific. I hope everybody does exactly those things. And hats off to the people who will be doing nothing differently, because obviously everything they've done works. But let's take a look at that. Investing in new software and technology. There's the annual upgrade cycle. But we have new ways of combining investing in new technology with planning early, where 44% of the people are planning to plan early and 49% are planning to reach out to clients proactively. So there are technology enablers that do all of the rest of the things that we want to do, including get more clients. I'm really encouraged by these numbers. I hope everybody follows through on that. That would be just awesome, totally awesome. So if there's anything we missed here, drop us a line, make a note of it in the chat or the question boxes. Let me take a look, but I want to take a look at something. I want to show everybody the difference between the problems that winners have and the problems that losers have. Now, we were able to rate firms and practices as winners or losers based on how effective they are at achieving their self-given objectives. And the winners are the ones that achieve their self-given objectives. And objectives for every firm and owner might be different. Might be more time off, might be more money. It might be growing the practice. It might be getting more clients and taking a hit on profits while you do that. It might be staffing up. It might be technical quality. It might be employee morale. It might be any other things. Whatever your objectives are, is how we judge success here, because we know that the tax professionals really have a wonderful way of tax professionals have a lifestyle choice they've made in order to build the kind of business they want, build the kind of life they want, work with the kind of people they want to work with, whether they're people or staff or clients. And that's one of the things that makes the tax business such a great business to be in. And the losers are the ones who don't quite get what they want. So among those who were predicting a better year ahead, staffing issues emerged as one of the biggest headaches. Technology and software problems were a big differentiator between the winners and the losers. And security, privacy, and identity issues were a big differentiator as well. Clients and client management is a big differentiator. So when we look at some of these things, what we see is that the things that you can control, the things that are within the control of a firm and its owners and its staff differentiate the firms that succeed at what they're doing and those that really don't. The way to achieve success in this business is to get security, privacy, and identity theft down, lock it down early. It's about processes, procedures, manuals, handbooks, and checklists. It's about people. It's not just about technology. It's about managing clients. It's about managing staff. These are things that we can manage. It's about getting software right, getting installed early, and getting everybody trained on it. A tax practice is an eminently manageable business. It should work like clockwork. In fact, it has to. There's a drop-dead deadline that has to be achieved. No doubt about it. And there's no way out. So with that, I'm going to start to wrap it up a little bit. I'm going to refer you to 109 pages of additional survey results, analysis, benchmarks, tips, and expert guidance. There's a URL here, and I know it's downloadable from the webinar sidebar. And as well, I wanted to draw your attention to some of the areas that you can start thinking about. And these are the things that are in your handout. Some of the things that we publish at CPA Trendlines, some of the things you'll find at cpatrendlines.com and at store.cpatrendlines.com. There are 10 quick and easy tips for a better tax season. There is a question about that annual tax meeting. Clients don't like it. They don't like it because they don't get anything out of it. But if you can provide value, you can charge for it. There are some very basic avoidable tax filing errors, and we've got a checklist on 47 of them. There are easier ways to do this business, and we can list some of them for you. We've got 11 ways to get more tax clients, and I know about 23% of the people out there want more clients. 22 ways to get more business clients. Those are the great ones. We've got a 5-point action plan for turning tax scam threats into new opportunities. I mean, who among our clients, including ourselves, is not affected by the big data breach at that credit card rating agency? And as financial advisors to our clients, shouldn't we be proactively showing concern, maybe dropping a 10-point list of what to do about it into their email, to their tax newsletter, remind them that we're thinking about? And then we had Watson emerge last year at H&R Block. It's going to happen again this year. And the 1040 business is going to get tougher and tougher because of it. We've got that four-season practice model that I talked about earlier. I'd love you to take a closer look at that. That you can turn annual once-a-year clients to year-round clients. And there's about a dozen questions to ask for year-round billings. And then, you know, it's postseason now. It's not too late to start thinking about building those income streams year-round. You always want to get paid faster in tax season. And you always want to be very clear, or as clear as you possibly can be, with your clients. So that stuff can be written down, planned out, and scripts can be followed by everybody in the organization. Consistency, consistency, consistency simplifies a complicated tax season. Clearly, 10% of the people are not going to change what they did last year. That's consistency. Don't forget personal touch. Remember people's birthdays. You're never too busy during tax season to take a call. You're never too busy during tax season to take on a referral. We've got a tax season marketing plan ready for you. And we've got a list of little tax season leaks, little errors, little mistakes, little hiccups that can really cause damage. And hopefully we have a few ways that you can delight your tax season clients so that they'll just love you for the rest of the year and hopefully do exactly as they're told, which is what we all want from our clients, right? Well, Div, I think that about does it for me. Thank you.